हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू ऑनलाइन कोर्स ऑफ मैकेनिकल मेजरमेंट एंड मेट्रोलॉजी। माई सेल्फ अभिषेक त्रिवेदी फ्रॉम मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट एट LJ इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी। वी आर डिस्कसिंग लीनियर एंड एंगुलर मेजरमेंट। इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी हैव स्टार्टेड द सेकंड पोर्शन ऑफ द चैप्टर, दैट इज द एंगुलर मेजरमेंट, इन विच वी हैव डिस्कस द कंसेप्ट ऑफ द साइन बार, हाउ द साइन बार विल यूज फॉर द मेजरमेंट ऑफ द एंगल, एंड वॉट इज द बेसिक लिमिटेशन, वॉट इज द बेसिक रिक्वायरमेंट बिहाइंड द साइन बार। Today we are going to discuss the concept of sine center, or we can say what the setup required for the measurement of the conical shape angle, as well as we are going to discuss the concept of angle gauge and autocollimator. Probably today we are going to end up our chapter. So let us start with the concept of sine center. Sine center is used for measurement of the angle. Sine center is basically useful for the measurement of the angle of the conical workpiece as shown in the figure. The figure shows the concept of the measurement of conical shape workpiece. Now what do you mean by conical shape? Suppose you are taking a routine conventional cylinder and you are making a cross sections like this. Put a cross section, remove this particular material and remove this particular material. This is not the cone, this is the frustum of the cone, or we can say the cross section view of the cone. If this will be extended, then it will perform as a cone, but we have cut it out this particular portion as well. So this particular section, if I have to measure the angle of this particular section, if I have to measure this particular angle theta, then what I am supposed to do, I will use the sine center as the basic concept for the measurement. To use the sine center for the conical workpiece, we have to provide the dead centers. The same concept has been followed in the basic concept of the sine bar. Suppose this is your datum line, the roller 1 is there, the roller 2 is there, both the rollers are identical with each other, the horizontal line and the structure of the sine bar. In the conventional case, what we are supposed to do, we are simply providing our workpiece like this and then we are going to measure the measurement, do the measurement or perform the measurement. But in the second case, what we have done, we have extended the surfaces over here. The first surface is here and the second surface is here. Both the surfaces are work as a stand. The dead center has been provided as you are supposed to provide in the lathe machine, on which whatever the workpiece is there, you can hold the workpiece properly. If the shape of the workpiece is conical, you can easily hold the workpiece on this particular dead center, and then you are going to measure the same concept. Suppose if the initially the surface is like this, the downward surface is there, and if you have to perform the measurement, what you are supposed to do, you are simply lifting the one roller by providing the stack of the slip gauge over bottom of the roller, and then the top surface of the particular conical workpiece will be behaves as a perfect parallel to the base of the particular sine bar. And once it will behave as a parallel surface to the bottom of the sine bar, then I can say that whatever the conical workpiece is there, whatever the angle it has generated, the same angle has been, and by using this particular setup you can measure the angle of the conical workpiece. In the particular sine center, the one roller is pivoted to its own center, so on the other side the stack of the slip gauge has been placed, and by using such arrangement we are supposed to require the dial indicator and angle can be measured. The sine center can be useful for the measurement of the angle of up to 60 degree. The figure shows the actual image of the sine center, over which whatever the workpiece is there, we are supposed to provide the workpiece over here. These two are the dead centers, they are not live centers, they are the dead centers. And then by simply providing the stack of the slip gauge over here and lifting the particular workpiece, we can make sure that the top surface of the given component will be exactly parallel to the reference bottom line. and then we can measure the particular angle. So guys, this is the concept of the sine center. Now the next is angle gauge. The figure shows the concept of angle gauge. Angle gauge will be behaves same as the slip gauge. We have already discussed the concept of the slip gauge. In the slip gauge, what you are supposed to do, suppose I have to perform a 12.5 mm of the distance, then I will use 10 mm plus the second piece of 2 mm and the third piece of 0.5 mm, and I can make sure that the whole stack assembly will be behaves as a 12.5 mm perfectly. The same way, if I have to make the arrangement of, let's say, 35 degree, then what I am going to do, I will take 30 degree, I will take 5 degree. If I will put both the angle gauge in the same direction, I can say that it will behave as a 35 degree. If I have placed 30 degree and 5 degree in the opposite side of the 30 degree, then I can say that the angle gauge setup will be behaves as a 25 degree. The same concept has been discussed over here. Suppose the bottom of the block will be performed as a 30 degree. If in the same direction I will put the 5 degree, then the total angle will be behaves as a 35 degree. If I will change the direction of the 5 degree in the opposite side of the 30 degree, then the angle will be generated. The angle is known as a 25 degree each. The angle gauge works on the same principle of the slip gauge. The proper set of the angle gauge can be rung together like the ringing process has been performed, and it will build a suitable angle combination, or we can say the stack of the angle combinations. One special features is added in the angle gauge which is not available in the slip gauge, that is the subtraction of the set. In the particular slip gauge, you are supposed to manufacture the 12.5 by using 10 plus 2 plus 0.5, but you are not supposed to use 15 minus 2 minus 0.5. This particular subtraction is not possible in the slip gauge, whereas in the angle gauge, if you have to perform 30 degree, then you can use both the way. The first one, that is the 25 plus 5, whereas in the second case, 35 minus 5. If particular 25 and 5 degree has the same direction, then I can say that they are performing as a 30 degree. And if 35 and 5 are placed in the opposite direction, then it will also generate the 30 degree itself. So this is the basic advantage behind the use of the angle gauge. The particular figure shows the actual pictorial representation of the angle gauge. Now the last topic of the chapter, that is the optical instrument useful for the angle measurement, or we can say autocollimator. Concept of autocollimator. In the physics, we have already discussed this particular principle, the principle of optics theory. What the principle says, suppose a light source has been provided over here, and if the plate is placed from which the light source will be pointed out, and it will be getting deflected in the different directions. Suppose in this path of the light waves, if I will provide a kind of lens, then what the lens will do? Lens will behave for the transformation of the light rays. Suppose whatever the diffraction has been generated for the light source, the lens will make all the light rays in the parallel direction. Suppose this is the direction of the light rays in the parallel to each other. All the parallel rays will be directly hit the mirror and it will be reflected. Though this is the simple mirror, it will be reflected back in the same direction. Once the return rays will hit the lens will make it to coincide at the single point, and the point of generation of the light and the point of reflection, both the point are on the same position. This is the basic concept which we have already discussed in the physics, in the 11th 12th science as well. Now suppose I will deflect the position of the mirror in the particular angle like this, then what is happening? Whatever the light rays will be passed through this, it will change its original timing as well as it will change its original direction for the reflection. There might some chance that all the rays will be deflected by some particular angle, and once these deflected rays will be collected over the lens will again try to coincide on the single point. But here the point of generation of the light and the point of coincidence of the reflected rays, both the points are being deflected with some particular linear distance. Suppose the angle of deflection of the mirror, that is theta, then the lights which are going to be reflected will gain the angle of 2 theta. It means if I will tilt the mirror by some theta angle, then the light will be reflected in the same direction with the deflection of 2 theta degree. The second figure shows the concept of deflection, or we can say deflection of the mirror, and the concept of deflection of the point of incident and point of location. The first of all, the green light, you can check the green arrows will perform a proper system in which we are considering the mirror as a straight position. Now what we are supposed to do, we are deflecting the mirror with the angle, let's say theta angle. Once the mirror will be deflected by some angle theta, it will be a case where the reflected light will be deflected by some angle, let's say 2 theta angle, and the deflected light will be coincide on the lens, and lens will collect all the lights on the some another position. So I can say that the O', that is the point of reflection, and the O, that is the point of source, both the points O and O' will be deflected by the some linear distance. As per the trigonometry principle, suppose this is the O' and O, if I were to measure the angle 2 theta, then I can use the concept of tan 2 theta. Tan 2 theta is equal to O of O dash divided by F, where F, that is the focal length. For any kind of lens, the value of F has been fixed because that is the focal length. So by using this particular concept, I can measure the distance, the linear distance between the point O and O dash, that is the X, and X is equal to 2 F theta, where 2, that is a constant value, and F, that is the focal length. So by using this, or we can say by measuring the value of X by the linear measurement, I can check the value of theta, like X divided by 2 of F, where X will be going to measured, where X is going to measured by the linear dimensioning system, and F, that is the focal, which is predefined. So by using such concept, you can measure the angle theta. The figure shows the working principle of photocollimeter. For any small angle of the tilt of the given reflector, it will directly shows the linear displacement of the reflection in the point of reflection. Now the actual concept of autocollimeter, how the autocollimeter will work. The figure shows the schematic view of the autocollimeter, in which the basic component has been provided. Here the point of incident, the high eyepiece has been provided over here, the filters or red screen has been provided over here. These are the red screen as well as the filters, different filters for the filtering the eye visible light. The beam splitter has been provided over here, the lamp, then the diffuser, and the cross line graticule has been provided. The objective has been provided over here. Now what is happening? Once the lamp has been started, the lamp will provide some sort of light. Due to the diffuser, the light source will be diffused in the single position, or we can say the cross line graticule, then it will be reflected in the opposite lines. A beam splitter has been provided. What the beam splitter will do? The beam splitter will directly deflect the light source in the particular direction. Suppose the light has been deflected like this, it will pass through the objective lens. As we already discussed, that if the lens has been provided, it will make the deflected light rays in the single path. Suppose this is in the single path. A mirror has been provided, Due to the proper simple mirror, the light will be reflected back in the original direction. It will also coincide with the proper angle by objective lens, and then the point of crossing of the light rays has been generated, and then again the light has been crossed and it will pass through the eyepiece. Eyepiece is also one sort of lens. So what it will do, it will make the deflected light rays in the parallel direction, and this is our viewpoint from which we can check the particular setup. Now once the mirror has been deflected, you can check on the screen. The dark blue line shows the initial condition which we have already discussed in the first figure and the second figure, or we can say the blue dot line will shows the tilt position of the mirror. Once the mirror will be tilted, we can say by using the theta, it will shows some sort of deflection in the reflected light rays, and once the light rays has been reflected, it will change the position of the initial reflection and the second reflection. And by using the linear distancing between these two, we can check what is the angle change of the given mirror. Autocollimator is used for the measurement of the straightness and flatness in the machine part and the accessories like the guideways, machine tables and so on. Assessment of the parallelism of the machine slide movement on the guideways is also performed by using the autocollimator. It will also used in the calibration of angle gauges as well. So guys, today what we have discussed, we have discussed the concept of sign center, then angle gauge, and then the concept of autocollimator. So this is the end of chapter. From the next lecture, we are going to start our new chapter. Till then, thank you.